Shall we pray? Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are God. We are very grateful to you for the gift of life. We thank you for showing us mercy and your compassion. We hallow and we honor you to this morning for who you are. You have been compassionate unto mankind. With all our unfaithfulness and the sins we have committed against you, you have still kept us up to today, giving us another opportunity to make amends. Lord, we thank you. We honor you. We pray that as we have gathered to in our homes to hear God's word, you would speak to us. You would change our way of life. You would shape our lives. You would empower us with wisdom and knowledge that would make us grow and become the people you want us to be. Make us candidate for heaven as we hear your word today. Let me be a blessing to the hundreds and thousands of people who would watch me this morning. I bless you, Lord, and I honor you for hearing me. In Jesus' name I pray with thanksgiving. Amen. Once again, I would like to take this opportunity to welcome all of us on board to the Throne Room Encounter, which is our usual Sunday morning service. It's my pleasure coming your way today also with the word of the Lord. Last month, our theme for the month was using the fellowship of godly relationship to activating the supernatural. This month, our theme for the month of May is using the fellowship of excellence to activating the supernatural experiences. As we have always been saying, that our theme for the year is fellowship of the Holy Spirit for supernatural experiences. And in each month, we try to break it down by using a theme that can relate to us and help us practice fellowship in the Holy Spirit or of the Holy Spirit. So, like I said, in this month of May, or for this month of May, our theme is using the fellowship of excellence to activating the supernatural experiences upon our lives. And I trust God that your life will never be the same. So turn your Bibles with me to Genesis chapter 24. Genesis chapter 24, and then we would read from verses 1 to 9. As a matter of fact, we'll be talking about the whole chapter, almost the whole chapter of Genesis chapter 24, but we'll take it bit by bit as we move on in this series. So I would like us to read just the few 9 verses, and then we trust God for his illumination and the anointing to speak today. Abraham was now very old, and the Lord has blessed him in every way. he said to the senior servant in his household, the one in charge of all that he had, put your hand under my thigh. I want you to swear by the Lord, the God of heaven and the God of earth, that you will not get a wife for my son from the daughters of the Canaanite among whom I am living, but will go to my country and my own relatives and get a wife for my son Isaac. The servant asked him, what if the woman is unwilling to come back with me to this land? Shall I then take your son back to the country you came from? Make sure that you do not take my son back there, Abraham said. The Lord, the God of heaven, who brought me out of my father's household and my native land, who spoke to me and promised me an oath, saying, to your offspring I will give this land. He will send his angel before you so that you can get a wife for my son from there. If the woman is unwilling to come back with you, then you will be released from this oath of mine. Only do not take my son back there. So the servant put his hand under the thigh of his master Abraham and swore an oath to take him, swore an oath to him concerning this matter. The Lord bless the reading of his word. In Jesus' name, amen. Like I usually do when I am starting a new series, I usually want to dedicate the first Sunday to do my introduction. I do this because I want everybody to follow me and to get a clear picture of what I will be talking about in the subsequent Sundays. So again, I will try to dedicate today, which is the first Sunday of the month, to my introduction, and then subsequently we'll get into God's word proper. However, if we have time, we may go a little bit into the main idea or the main sermon or the main body of the sermon, so that we can learn some more. In Jesus' name, praise the Lord. Amen. So please get me and then bear with me. Follow me carefully as we begin this series. I have realized that every employer or anyone who hires a person or who hires a worker expects that the worker or the workers or the people he has hired excel and demonstrate mastery in the assignment he is asking them to do. When you went for the interview, or when people go for interview, one of the important skills the interviewers look out for is one who is matured, who is experienced, knowledgeable, and has the ability to perform the exact assignment they are employing to do, and to do it with a touch and become excellent. So you realize that among the many people who attend the interview, they would pick, according to their estimation, the best, out of the many. Although qualification matters in interviews or when one is attending an interview for employment, because it tells the amount of knowledge the person has acquired, but aside that, they look out for other things, because it is not only the certificate or the book knowledge one would acquire or need to perform that task. They look out for other qualities, because the employer is looking for the best in the person he wants to hire. He is doing that simply because he wants the person to come and perform better and add to the knowledge. He wants the person he is employing to come and demonstrate excellence in order to raise the image and the status of that institution. So in every workspace or in every work environment or in every establishment, whatever that establishment is, either in the secular world or in the religious circles or in the political world or in education, in every environment, everywhere, excellence is the hallmark of the establishment or any institution. Once you don't want to excel, you will lose out of it. So even in your own private business, in state-owned enterprises and all that, hallmark is simply excellence. So if you are not ready to excel, they are not ready to accommodate you. My prayer is that check your output. If you are not liked in the workplace, if people don't flow with, or something is happening to you in that environment, in that workplace, and you think that it is incorrect, it is improper, do a credit card analysis of yourself and see if you are demonstrating excellence. You know, excellent people are a treasure in every serious and purposeful organization. No organization would dispense the services or would dispense of the services of an excellent person. Then they are not serious. In any case, for us in this part of the world, we are motivated by our family lineages or inclinations and our immoral aspect of our life. So when we are employing, we choose people we can manipulate, people we can just abuse, people who can offer sex for employment, people who have political colors and party cards. These are the things we look out for when we are hiring or employing people. But in every serious and purposeful organization, excellent people are a treasure, because they know what they can do to the fortunes of this institution. You know, anytime there is a swearing-in ceremony, either it is swearing in by the president or by a minister of state or by the chief justice, swearing in lawyers, judges, whatever, I have found out that one advice that easily runs through or that would show up before the ceremony is over is the advice and telling the appointees to observe their duties without partiality or without fear or favor, and also demonstrate excellence in the work they have been appointed to do. Over the years, you know, when ministers are appointed and the president swears them in, the president will say that, "Don't disappoint me. Go and demonstrate excellence. Go and do this. Go and do that." Why? Because the president is expecting them to demonstrate excellence and mastery in the work they are doing. Because his success as a president depends on what the appointees will do. The appointees will in turn respond to this advice by also pledging their allegiance to the president or the appointing officer, and also assuring them or assuring him or her of their commitment and demonstration of excellence or commitment to excellence to the work they have been appointed to do. I mean, no one employs or appoints someone without expecting some form of excellent outcome. Then it is not any serious organization. It is not done. Praise the Lord. I remember at our graduation ceremony from the Bible College, the General Superintendent of Assemblies of God Ghana charged all of us graduates to demonstrate excellence in our pastoral duty or call. I mean, he cited the example of the decay in our moral lifestyle and how depraved the world is now becoming, and that there are pastors, but their impact and effect cannot be felt. And he charged us that within this environment of weak moral standards, within this environment of sin and evil, we should demonstrate excellence in this call. I mean, and this kind of advice, not only did it occur at our place, but I'm sure every year it is said at almost every Bible institution that trains pastors. I am sure they will give this advice because they want them to come out and demonstrate excellence in the work they do. A servant who is successful and trustworthy always enjoys considerable favor from his master. And this is supported by fact, you know, that if he tries to demonstrate excellence at home, he is the beloved of the parent. I have also found out that any company where there are the staff, or if there is one staff in that company who is faithful, who serves in faithfulness and demonstrate excellence, I mean, he is liked by almost everybody in the company. And every opportunity that comes, that is available, if they want one person, it would be him, because people usually would respond to people who are excellent in their dealings. I mean, any opportunity that comes, in every serious, determined, purposeful, growth-driven organization, if there is any opportunity for a worker or to motivate workers, they would give to the one who always demonstrates excellence in his dealings. Because excellence rewarding and excellence pays off. Everyone who serves well in the church also and demonstrate excellence becomes liked by everybody. I mean, automatically gets closer to the leadership of the church, and everybody in the church begins to like that person because of that element of excellence. That is why we want to study this month about excellence and how excellence would help us, how we can be excellent in our dealings, because excellence always has proven to be rewarding. That all those who have demonstrated excellence in their dealing have never regretted it. They have always enjoyed the favors, they have always enjoyed the blessings. Sometimes they would not even pray for it, but because of their excellence in dealing, the door just keeps opening. So my prayer is that you and I must demonstrate excellence in whatever we are doing. As Christians, we should do everything within our power. We should do everything possible we can to excel in every assignment that has been assigned to us. You know, by so doing, we can enjoy the goodies from men and God. My prayer is that in that work you have been assigned to do, though the salary or the paycheck will not be much, though it will not be motivating enough, but demonstrate excellence. Because it is not only the paycheck we get, it is not only the salaries we get that sustain us, it is the favors and the goodness we enjoy from the work that brings us that wealth, that puts us on that place of excellence or that place of success. Remember that the salaries as negotiated for, the salaries or the paycheck as it appears on your payslip, is only a small fraction of the amount of money you spend or you earn. But you realize that because of your excellence, there are some favors you earn from the workplace. There are some opportunities that come your way. There are some boards you may serve on, some assignment that will bring extra income they may appoint you to do, without necessarily coming from your salary. It is because of excellence. So as we demonstrate excellence in the assignment we have been assigned, in the task we have been assigned, we would enjoy the goodness from both men and also from God. By so doing, we would then activate the supernatural experience upon our lives. By so doing, we would touch the heart of God, and God will begin to intervene. God will speak for us. God will do the things we have so badly needed because of the excellence we are demonstrating to Him and for His work. My prayer is that all of us will spend our energy and resources, everything within our power, or the task assigned to us. Therefore, every Christian, whoever you are hearing me today, you should and you must work hard to become excellent in your assignment or in the task assigned you, both in your secular work and also in the church. Every assignment assigned you, you must demonstrate excellence. You know, let me give you a little background of the passage we read from Genesis chapter number 24. You know, God called Abraham from his native land to a place he did not know. Abraham was living with his family members, and the Lord called him to get out of that place. God promised to give Abraham that land he is taking him to for his possession. And it will not only be for him, but it will be for him and his children after him. Many people have sacrificed their future because of marriage. Many people have locked their talent and their gift in the room of marriage, and they are unable to excel. I mean, many young, talented, gifted people, very promising, the moment they married, that was the end of whatever they were asked to do. Child of God, my advice, or what the Word of God want us to know, is that before you decide on marriage, before you admit any proposal from a guy, before you go out and make a proposal to a lady, please be mindful of your future and your ability before you say yes. Especially my young ladies, those of us who are yet to marry, my advice to us is that before you say yes to every man's proposal for marriage, ask yourself, how do I want my future to be? Is my future going to be enhanced in the company of this guy? If you don't spend time to do it today, you will spend the rest of your life in a crushed home without fulfillment. Abraham, very old and about to die, but he knew that the person who becomes the wife of his son can change or hinder God's promises from coming to pass. God does not have a problem in fulfilling his assignment or his promise in our lives. We are the problem. We decide to avail ourselves or not to. We decide to believe in God's word or not to. So the fulfillment basically depends on what we do, our actions, because God cannot force himself on us. Abraham, that old wise man, decided to influence who becomes the wife of his son. And so Abraham called his chief servant, the one in charge of everything in his house. I am sure Abraham believed in that person. I am sure Abraham was confident in his abilities. I am sure Abraham knew what this guy was able to do. And so he trusted him and had confidence in his ability to execute the task going to be assigned to him to a perfect finish. Abraham was in no doubt, thinking that the guy can fail. But as a human being, where we cannot make predictions about our actions and what we're going to do, Abraham called his young servant and asked him Abraham wanted to commit himself to the promise, so he asked the young man to swear before he sent him to go and do what he wanted him to do. Abraham told this young man not to get a wife or go get a wife for his son Isaac, but he must not get that wife from Canaan where he lives. But Abraham told him to go to his native land, his homeland, where his family members were, and that was where he was to choose a wife for his son Isaac. Abraham, after that assignment was offered, or that task was assigned, the servant released him to go and execute the task. When Abraham released the young man to go, he had a set of target or principle or an expected outcome of what the servant's task should be. Abraham, in his mind, knew what would be the end result of the task he has assigned the young man. So the responsibility was on this guy to go and fulfill the task. He was then supposed to come back with the exact precision as dictated by the task. So this young man left for the task. Although it was a very difficult task, the servant knew his master trusted him to excel. That was why he sent him on that assignment. Very difficult, yes. Because I don't know whether at the time Abraham left his house or his native land in Haran, he had acquired that young man as a servant, or that young man lived with him. So it is for me unclear whether the young man knew the father's house or the native land or the family members of Abraham. So this young man, is assigned a very difficult task, a task which needs tact, carefulness, but excellence was his hallmark. He decided to excel because he expected, or he knew his master was expecting that outcome from him. So this young man set out with the mind to excel and to bring back positive. The servant was able to execute the assignment to perfection, to the glory of God. The young man brought a wife from the native land of Abraham, from his father's household. That is where the young man got that woman from and brought him to his master's house. The servant got it right on point and did not fail. Wow. At the time he came, he got it very right. Brought the wife exactly from his family, from his father's house. He did not fail. I mean, not one aspect of the assignment failed. Child of God, excellence is rewarded. When you set out to excel, you will definitely receive the answers. You will definitely get the work done because excellence is rewarded. Praise the Lord. Once you determine to do it, you want to be excellent, you would always achieve your results, I mean, 100%. Even if not 100%, I'm sure you achieve your result by 90-something, 96, 97, 98%. The servant came home very, very fulfilled because excellence is rewarded. On the other hand, I mean, Abraham would be very happy and excited knowing that the servant executed the task to perfection. And the servant also would be very, very happy for a job well done. Because I am sure when he was setting out, he was confused. As you will see in the passage, he was uncertain. He didn't know what, but he trusted God. And the Lord responded to a heart of excellence, one who wanted to excel. And this young man, or this servant, came home very, very happy and with joy in his heart. Why? Because excellence is fulfilling. Excellence will not only reward your effort, but it will make you also fulfilled. What a joy when you see that the things you set out to do are coming to pass, are being fulfilled because of your diligence and excellence. My prayer is that you would make excellence your hallmark, because not only would excellence reward your effort, but excellence would also bring you fulfillment. Now the question is, how did the servant achieve or succeed and excel in this difficult task his master assigned him? This question is what we are trying to answer in the next remaining four Sundays of this month of April, as we study how we can become excellent in our assignment. My prayer is that the Lord will help us go through this process, or this series, or this sermon, acquiring knowledge that would help us be able to become God's people who are serious, who are purpose-driven, who are motivated by excellence, and that will seek to excel. My purpose or my objective is that when this series or this sermon is done, or this series for this whole month of April is done, after studying this word or this passage in Genesis chapter 24, all of us, you and I, will be able to identify those things that would help us to excel, or we'll be able to tell on and identify, fish out those things in life that would help us become excellent in executing every task assigned us. And once we've been able to identify those things in life, those things that would help us or that will enable us to excel and become excellent in our task, we also will not just identify them, but we'll go ahead to practice them in our everyday task, in our everyday work with the Lord, in our everyday activities, in everything we do, whether you are in your secular world, whether you are in the church, whether in your marital home, whether in your own business, wherever you will find yourself, you will then apply these principles that would enable you then become excellent in your assignment. My prayer is that today the Lord would help us so that all of us would live a life of excellence, because excellence, like we said, is rewarding. Anytime you demonstrate excellence, your dealings, the end result is reward. When you are going through it, you will not have the reward in the process. Some may do, but always when your task is done, and that your reward or your achievement excels, or what you were assigned to do, you excel in it, the result is your reward. As we walk this week and in this month, let's make excellence our hallmark. Let's make excellence our target, because there are so many things God wants to bring our way, but when He's weighing us, our hearts tells we cannot excel, and so God holds back. There are many people who are looking for those who want to be excellent and employed. I mean, managers, institutions are looking for young, energetic people who will demonstrate excellence and reward them and give them jobs, but yet they can't find. But if you and I would live a life of excellence, trust me, your effort will be rewarded. I mean, it's becoming a headache for many entrepreneurs, many people who want to retire from their services and from their business, because they don't know who will take over. Even their own family members take family businesses and they mess it up because they don't have the heart to excel. But if you would demonstrate excellence, they would sideline all family members, they will sideline all close relations and come in for you. God can do it for you. I mean, when it comes to God's supernatural dealings, in most cases it is His doing and no other man's involvement. It does not take somebody's suggestion or man's involvement to get God to do it for you. If God wants to do it, God can easily do it without any man's involvement, any connection, anything. If God sees someone who is ready to demonstrate excellence, promotion is inevitable. Praise the Lord. If you demonstrate excellence in your dealing, if God sees excellence in whatever you are doing, your promotion, your excellence is inevitable. Praise the Lord. I mean, you hear people, then people start fighting you. Then people will start do so many things against you because they think he's getting so many offers, he's getting so many opportunities. And he's the darling boy of everybody, and everybody, any job they call him, anything they call him, whatever they call him, so and so they call him. But it is because of your attitude of excellence. I mean, I have not seen any excellent person who is at home struggling to survive. I have not seen one who is excellent in his dailies struggling to survive or to make end meet in his household. Not one. Secret to life is God working through an excellent person. I mean, I have seen people who are not Christians and are applying the principle of excellence, and it is working for them. Why are we as Christians not applying same principles and thinking that everything is about fasting and prayers, thinking that everything is about anointing, thinking that everything is about seed sowing? Child of God, it is important and very good to sow seed. It is important, it is rewarding to fast and pray, because you can't, prayer answers everything. But child of God, you may not waste all the time praying and fasting and thinking that, God out of his magnanimity would come in to help. But if you can demonstrate excellence, things would begin to happen even when your enemies are all around you. Praise the Lord. The enemies would be around. The people who speak against you would be around. But because of your excellence, the work will still come to you. You know, a story is told about a young man who he was working in an establishment and there was a vacancy. So the second in command in that establishment wanted to fix that young man there. But some powers that be in the company didn't want that person to be offered that position. You know, but because of his excellent nature, he got that position, because it was obvious, and everybody at that time knew that with that office and how sensitive that office is, it would take only that young man to be able to fail it. And indeed, he managed that office with excellence. You know, when the HR people and all those people who were to write the appointment letter were against him, he still managed to secure the place because of his excellence in executing his task. I don't know what you think is going against you. Try excellence. Try to implement excellence in your life. You realize that excellence is rewarding. If your husband is always fighting you, if there is so much confusion at home, try excellence. Try to be excellent in your dealing, excellence in your marriage. Try how you even show love to your children. Be excellent in that. How you show love and respect to your husband. Be excellent. Move to the next level and realize that the same man who didn't want to see your face will then now turn his attention to you. The children who didn't like you will then turn their attention to you. It is unnecessary to even think that I'm going to get some juju to do a man because I want him to do, I want him to behave, do as you say, or those kind of, rubbish sometimes you hear on the radio. An excellent life would always be a door opener. An excellent life would always become a door opener. When people are struggling, when you become excellent in your life, it will open the door for you. And once excellence brings the reward, your excellence will grant you fulfillment. Your excellence will grant you fulfillment. How happy would you be knowing that all the things you set out to do, you have been able to achieve them. How happy would you be when you know that I am succeeding in the things I set out to do? I mean, I wanted to do A, B, C, D. And now when you go out, you realize that all of them have been achieved to perfection. How happy would you be? How exciting would you be? How fulfilling would that be? Excellence is rewarding and excellence is fulfilling. Any student who has demonstrated excellence in his studies has always seen the rewards and he has been fulfilled. Praise the Lord. I mean, you cannot stay at home and become lazy student thinking that when they pray over a handkerchief and you spread it on your question paper, you can sleep at the end of stop work. Angels will come and write the examinations for you. I mean, it doesn't make sense. God does not deal with human beings on this kind of superfluous ideas. Praise the Lord. God does not deal with us like that. If you are diligent and want to excel in your studies, I mean, the rewards will be there in your hands, and that will bring you fulfillment. I mean, how ask the people who started their life in school and wanted a particular profession, and that they were able to grow to fulfill it or achieve it. You just engage them in a conversation and you will know that it was all due to excellence, and now they are fulfilled, they are happy practicing that kind of profession they wanted because they demonstrated excellence. Now, on the contrary, find out from people also who wanted to achieve or fulfill set some form of profession as their dream to fulfill it or to practice, and that because they could not and they lost it, ask them how they feel when they see people of that same profession. For example, somebody wanted to become a president or a teacher or something, and then for some reason he dropped out of school and could not become the teacher. Ask him how he feels if he sees teachers. A person always sees that something is in him that is not fulfilled. You know, in the university, I met this young guy who would always take part in our old student association meetings. He didn't attend the school I attended, but anytime our old student, like our association, we met as an association, this guy will be part of us. He will be part of our week celebrations. He will be part of almost everything we do. And the question we asked, I found out why he didn't attend the secondary school I did, and yet he was every day part of our meetings. And I learned that he said he wanted to go to that school. He had dreamt to be a student of that secondary school, but he was not able to make the grades to attend. I mean, when he sat for the common entrance, the grades he got at that time did not permit him to come to the secondary school. So he went to another secondary school. After Form 5, he tried to come to sixth form at that place. Yet, he still could not make it, you know. But he felt a dream unfulfilled. So trying to suppress or make him fulfilled is to join us in our association meeting. And his life is an example of many people today who are living in an unfulfilled lifestyle. If you are excellent in your dealings, you would always be fulfilled because you would receive the rewards of what you were set to do or you set out to do. Your answers or the task you set out to do, you would achieve it and you would bring fulfillment. Child of God, It is not over. If you failed in that aspect, you still have your life ahead of you. You still have some years ahead of you. Realign yourself. Reorganize your thought again and start living the principles of excellence. And God, who is a God of a second chance, will bring you reward and fulfilling. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord cause his face to shine towards you. And the Lord be gracious unto you and give you peace. My prayer is that from today, you would make a vow and a determination to be excellent in everything. Not only for this month of May, but after this month, you will still continue with the practice of excellence and your life will never be the same. Remember that this is a series we have started, and we have started today. Like I said, I always use my first Sunday to introduce my sermon. So this is the introduction, and next week we will go deep into the passage and study how we can become excellent in our assigned task. Remember, our theme for this month is using the fellowship of excellence to activating the supernatural. The Lord bless you. In Jesus' name, shall we pray? Heavenly Father, I thank you for the preaching of your word. Lord, my prayer is that you will let this sermon arrest every heart. Let the ideas from this sermon arrest every heart, that we will demonstrate excellence so that we can receive the rewards associated with excellence, and then we can also be fulfilling or live a fulfilled life. Help every one of us. Help me, oh God, to become excellent in this call as a pastor. Lord, help me to do this work with excellence in Jesus' name. Help our leaders to work or do this work they are doing with excellence, not with the motivation of greed, but they would all excel in the name of Jesus. I pray, oh God, help every one of us to live an excellent life. In Jesus' name, I pray with thanksgiving. Amen. Child of God, maybe you are watching me from your homes or wherever you are watching this video. You know that you have not accepted the Lord Jesus as your Savior, and that you don't know where you're going to spend your eternity. Believe me or not, life will not end just in your grave. After the grave, there is life beyond it. And my prayer is that you would take that important decision today, so that when you died, you would have a place, a better place, to spend eternity. It is because of you that Jesus came. It is because of you that he died. It is because of you that he hung on the cross, so that you, through his work, would receive grace and salvation. So if you would like to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, pray this prayer of faith after me. Say, Lord Jesus, I thank you today. I am grateful for this opportunity granted me today. I have heard your word, and I admit I am a sinner. I have taken to my own ways. Father, forgive me. I believe in the work you did on the cross, that you died to save me from my sins, that believing in you and believing that you died and that you were raised from the dead, my salvation is granted. I believe this with all my heart. Therefore, save me. Make me one of your own. write my name in the book of life. This I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a wonderful Sunday. In Jesus' name.